Take your Bibles and turn with me to Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3. We have been in a verse-by-verse series through the wonderful, awesome, challenging book of Romans. It's been a wonderful journey so far. We've come now to the last part of chapter 3. I want to direct your attention to the words that are found in verses 29 and 30. 29, 30, 31. Romans chapter 3, we'll begin reading at verse 29. If you don't have a Bible, just raise your hand. We have some extra Bibles in the back. We would love to get one to you so you can follow along with us. All right. Romans chapter 3, beginning in verse 29. Are you ready for the scripture? Well, that was real weak, church. I know we're trying to wake up this morning, but I expect you to respond. Are you ready, Brother Troy? Amen. All right, let's look at the scripture together. Romans 3, verse 29. Or is God the God of the Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles also? Yes. Of Gentiles also, since indeed God, who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith, is one. Do we then nullify the law through faith? May it never be. On the contrary, we establish the law. Let's ask God to help us to understand what he means by what he says in his word. Okay, let's ask God to help us. Father, give us understanding of your word. Give us ears to hear what your spirit would say to us. And be with my mouth that I may speak only what you would have me to speak. In Jesus' name, amen. As a child, growing up in the inner city, many of the most important lessons of my life were learned on the tail end of my daddy's belt. But not every act of discipline proved to be an effective teacher. As a Christian, God also teaches his children through trials and through hardships and even discipline. But did you know that there's actually a more effective way of learning the great lessons of life? According to the Word of God, we learn some of the greatest lessons of life by understanding the gospel of grace. The writer of the letter to the Hebrews understood this when he wrote in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 9, "Do not be carried away by varied and strange teachings, for it is good for the heart to be strengthened." How? By grace. My understanding is that it is good for the heart to be strengthened by the teachings of grace, by the doctrines of grace. In this closing section, Paul is seeking to set before us some life-changing lessons from grace. And he does this by showing us how the gospel solves three of the most common problems that we as sinners face. The first problem is that of boasting. The second problem is that of discrimination. The third problem is that of law-keeping. In our last message, we addressed the first problem of boasting in verses 27 and 28. And if you were listening, you should have walked away with at least this in your heart and mind, that our boasting is often misplaced. We draw our identity and our self-worth from things that cannot save us. We boast in things we have. We boast in things that we do. We boast in people we love or who loves us. But we're told, according to the Word of God, that we ought not to boast in those things. That we ought not to boast in riches or in might or in wisdom, but if we're going to boast in anything, we are to boast in the Lord. Let him who boasts, boast in the Lord. Now in these remaining verses of chapter 3, Paul addresses the final two problems that the gospel solves. It is the problem of discrimination and the problem of law-keeping. Let's look again at these verses and ask God to help us as we consider what Paul says to us. Notice, let your eyes drop again to the page. Or is God the God of the Jews only? Is he not the God of the Gentiles also? Yes, of Gentiles also. Since indeed God, who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith, is one. Do we then nullify the law through faith? May it never be. On the contrary, we establish the law. Are you a prejudiced person? Do you have any discriminating qualities about you? A month or so ago, I attempted to prove to you that we're all prejudiced against snakes. We all have some prejudice against those reptiles. We don't all like snakes. We have this prejudice against them. But the discrimination that I'm speaking of in this text is not about reptiles. It's about people. It was Art Linkletter who once said that a prejudiced person is one who doesn't believe in the same things that we do. And that's an interesting way of putting it, because often if someone doesn't believe the same things we do, we accuse them of being prejudiced, but we're often prejudiced on different issues. The question is, how does the gospel solve the issue of discrimination? How? And the answer is that the gospel declares that there is only one way of salvation for everyone. There's only one way of salvation for everyone. This is how Paul puts it here. Notice it in verse 29. He begins verse 29 with two rhetorical questions which anticipates an obvious answer. The first question anticipates a negative answer. The second question, a positive answer. First, is God the God of the Jews only? It anticipates the answer, no, no. Now, with this first question, Paul is addressing the discrimination that is connected with one of the core tenets of the Jewish faith. And that is their belief that there is only one God. The word that we use to explain a belief in only one God is monotheism. Mono means one, theism means, or theo means God. So you put those two together and you have monotheism. It's a simple word, but it just simply means a belief in one God. Now you've heard perhaps of polytheism, a belief in many gods. Perhaps you've heard of pluralism, the belief that there are many ways to God. Certainly, you have heard of atheism, a belief that there is no God. But here we discover that the Jews rightly boasted in this truth, that there is only one God. There's not one big God and lots of other smaller, lesser gods, as Greek mythology suggests, but there is only one God. Everything else is a creature. Everything else is an idol. There is only one God. Now, the declaration of their faith at this point is found in the Old Testament in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4, in the great statement known as the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God. The Lord is one. It was the chief theological tenet of Judaism, and it still is today. It is the one thing that distinguished Jews from Gentiles or their pagan neighbors. Gentiles believed in all sorts of false deities, but the Jews were steadfast in maintaining this very high and holy truth, and that is that there is only one God and that He was their God. I can give you a number of scriptures that prove that from the Old Testament. I stopped counting at about 28, but there are many references that affirm this truth, that there is only one God. Now, most Jews knew that God was not limited to one nation. And Paul, here in our text, is not seeking to argue monotheism, but rather he is seeking to attack one point that a self-righteous Jew would find difficult to accept, and that is that God would justify the Jews on the same footing as He would the Gentiles. Are there two standards, one for the Jew, one for the Gentile? Are there two ways of salvation, one for the Jew, one for the Gentile? Paul says, no, there are not two standards. There are not two ways. Now, what this led to in the mind of the Jewish person of that day and time was a theological exclusiveness. And that theological exclusiveness degenerated. In other words, what it led to is it led the Jews to scorn the Gentiles. So much so that in one of their morning prayers, they would say, God, I thank Thee that I'm not a Gentile, a slave, or a woman. They were very discriminatory in some of their statements and some of their thoughts. You recall in John chapter 4, when Jesus went through the land of Samaria, He said, I had to go through Samaria. Why? Because the Jews had no dealings with Samaritans. There was prejudice. There was discrimination going on. And Jesus says, no, I have to go through that area because I'm going to meet a woman at a well and I'm going to save her just the same way that I will save Nicodemus when he believes in Me. And so this was an issue in that day and time. But with this one question, the Apostle Paul causes us to reflect on what the Bible means. Is God the God of the Jews only? He's inviting us to think. Do we believe that there's only one God? Do we believe that every other so-called God is nothing but an idol or a creature? Do we believe that there is only one God? Do we really believe that? Monotheism means that God is not the exclusive property of any one nation. Monotheism teaches that God is not the God of a denomination or a race or a people. But since there is only one God, then He must be the God of all people. We read of this in Psalm 24, verse 1. The earth is the Lord's and all it contains, the world and those who dwell in it. The entire Old Testament celebrates Jehovah as the God of all the earth. In Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 7, Jeremiah called God the King of the nations. Paul says, this one and only God, is He the God of the Jews only? No, He is not. Is He not the God of the Gentiles also? And He answers that question. He's looking for an affirmative answer, but then He just supplies it. He says, yes. Yes, of Gentiles also. Now, what is Paul's point? Write this down somewhere and don't forget it. There is only one God, And this God does not exclusively belong to one group or another, but everyone, both Jew and Gentile, belongs to him. Let me say that again. Every person belongs to God. Everyone, saved or lost, belong to God. Souls do not belong to Satan. Souls belong to God. Ezekiel 18, God says, all souls belong to me. So no soul, no person belongs to the devil. They actually belong to God, even in their lost state. Satan himself belongs to God. Luther said that the devil is God's devil. And so this is why when every person stands before God and God sends a sinner to hell, it will be because God sends them to hell, not because Satan sends them there. The devil will be sent to hell by God himself. So here's the question. The question is not whether you belong to God or not. That's not the question. The question is, do you know him? Do you know him? Has this God, to whom you already belong, has he forgiven you of your sins? Has he declared you righteous? Have you been put in the right before him? You see, that's the question. And oh, I need to labor at this point just for a moment. It's very, very important that we understand this. Because see, we can say unrightly so and incorrectly so that some person belongs to the devil. No, they don't. No sinner belongs to the devil. He may be under the devil's deception. He may be under the devil's influence, but all souls belong to God. Now, this does not mean that every person is a child of God. Every person is a creation of God, but only those who trust Christ are children of God. But let us be clear on this fact. Every human being will stand before God and give an account of themselves. And the question is not whether you belong to him or not, but the question is, do you know him savingly? Have you been forgiven by him? Have you been made right before him? Now let's labor at the back of this text just a little bit further here. In the mind of the Jew, there was hope for the Gentiles. They believed that the Gentiles could be saved. But if a Gentile would be saved, then he would have to become a Jew first. And we find this mentality in the Old Testament, but it slid all the way down into the New Testament, and we find Judaizers actually undermining the gospel of Paul, chasing him from city to city, always putting other demands on the Gentiles. Not that they would just repent and believe, but they had to be circumcised, and they had to keep the law of Moses. And Paul says, no way. No way. We see this all through the New Testament. Let me give you one example of this. Turn with me to Acts chapter 15. Acts chapter 15. Hold your finger there in Romans and turn with me quickly to Acts 15. I know I can just quote these verses to you and sometimes that's necessary, but oftentimes it's good for you to just look at the Word of God yourself and see it right before you. Acts chapter 15, let's begin at verse 1. Some men came down from Judea and began teaching the brethren, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. Did you see that? That's what they were saying. Now you say, well, Pastor, that's way back then. Does that happen today in the church? Mm-hmm. Yeah, they say, well, you know, Pastor, I believe they can be saved, but they must become a member of the church first. Or they must join our denomination. Or they must do the things we do. They must go to Bible study and home fellowship. And they must tithe. And they must do these things first before they're saved. We do the same thing subtly today, and we must watch it. This is what was happening in the early church. Verse 2, the Bible says, and when Paul and Barnabas had great dissension and debate with them, the brethren determined that Paul and Barnabas and some others of them should go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and elders concerning this issue. Therefore, being sent on their way by the church, they were passing through both Phoenicia and Samaria, describing in detail the conversion of the Gentiles, and were bringing great joy to all the brethren. Verse 4, and when they arrived at Jerusalem, they were received by the church and the apostles and the elders, and they reported all that God had done with them. But some of the sect of the Pharisees who had believed stood up, saying, it is necessary to circumcise them and to direct them to observe the law of Moses. Did you see that? So it was some Pharisees who had believed on Jesus. And yet they were still holding on to this false teaching and insisting that it be given in the church. We go on to read. Verse 6, the apostles and elders came together to look into the matter. After there had been much debate, Peter stood and said to them, brethren, you know that in the early days God made a choice among you that by my mouth the Gentiles would hear the word of the gospel and believe. And God, who knows the heart, testified to them, giving them the Holy Spirit, just as he also did to us. And he made no distinction between us and them, cleansing their hearts by faith. You see it? Verse 10. Therefore, why do you put God to the test by placing upon the neck of the disciples a yoke which neither our fathers nor we have been able to bear? But we believe that we are saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus in the same way as they also are. And so they stood on the gospel because they were saying what Paul is saying here, that Jews and Gentiles are saved the same way. The same way. Now again, how does this apply to us? This applies to us in a very personal way because, you see, we can begin to say that unless a person becomes a part of our church or become a part of, quote, our denomination or our group, that they cannot be saved. But the way they're saved is they join the church and trust Jesus. We must be careful about that. We must be very careful about that. I'm all for church membership. And I believe that, yes, that when you're born again, God makes you a part of the church and you ought to become a member of a church. I believe that with all of my heart. But listen, church membership is not required for salvation. Trusting Jesus is required for salvation. We move now from the Jews to the Gentiles. The Gentiles did not struggle with this theological exclusiveness, but they struggled with something else. They struggled with a permissive tolerance, a permissive tolerance. The Gentiles permitted all sorts of false gods and pagan practices. You recall that in Acts chapter 17, Paul ran into this inscription on an altar to an unknown god. They didn't have any problem including one more false deity into their long list of gods. For the problem of exclusiveness, Paul says God is the God of all. For the problem of tolerance, permissive tolerance, Paul says you must confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, that he is the one and only God. He cannot be a God among gods because there's only one God, and you must confess that Jesus is that God. He is Lord in order to be saved. We read of it in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. He goes on in verse 10 to say, for with the heart man believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. There is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, abounding in riches for all who call on him. We read in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5, for there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus. And so what the gospel does is it maintains monotheism, but it does not promote exclusivity. Now hear me. It proclaims that there is one God, that he sent his only son, he died for our sins, and by one sacrifice for all time, God has made a way for sinners, regardless of race, regardless of background, regardless of education, regardless of sin, he has made a way for every sinner to be made right with him through faith in Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. Charles Hodge put it this way: God is a universal, not a national God, and this method of salvation is universally applicable. Therefore, we go into all the world and we preach the gospel to every race, and we go to every person and we say that there is one God who saves one way through one person. That's faith in Jesus Christ. Can I get a witness here? In Christ, the blessings of salvation extend to everyone who believes, without exception, without distinction. And so the gospel excludes all boasting, and it excludes all discrimination. There's only one way of salvation for everyone. Now, before I move to our next point, I need to talk real plainly. I must answer four questions that is important for us to remind ourselves of if we're thinking properly about what we've heard. I need to ask the question and answer the question, who may come? And the answer is everybody. Everyone. All alike are lost in sin. And all alike are the object of God's saving love. There would be some who would say, well, you know, some people cannot come. Who says? That's not in the Word of God. Whatever your sin is it pride? Is it murder? Is it stealing? Is it adultery? Is it fornication? It does not matter. If you come to Jesus, the Bible says you will be received. Jesus said, he who comes to me, I will in no wise cast out. You can come, whoever you are. You say, how may I come? You can come just as you are. Some come running to Jesus, like Zacchaeus. Some come running to Jesus, wet and soaked, like Peter. Some come to Jesus, flattened, like Saul of Tarsus. Some come to Jesus informally, like Lydia, who heard the gospel and God just opened her heart and she responded to the things that she heard. And some come to Jesus faltering, reluctant, with questions, like Thomas. They're not sure. They need affirmation and they come and they're not sure, but they come. Jesus says you can come. Whether you're a Thomas, whether you're a Lydia, whether you're a Zacchaeus, whether you're a Peter, no matter who you are, you may come just as you are. C.S. Lewis described himself as one of the most dejected and reluctant converts in England. You may not have every answer, but you can come to Jesus as you are. And he'll make you what you need to be. You said, when may I come to Jesus? When may I come? You may come at any time. You can come as a child. You don't have to wait till you become an adult to come to Jesus. You can come as a teenager. You don't need to wait until you've lived a life of sin and been broken by the sin of the world to come to Jesus. You can come as a teenager. You can come as an adult. You can come as an old man or an old woman. You can come to Jesus anytime. It's never too early. It's never too late to come to Jesus. C.H. Spurgeon put it this way. He said, come in the morning when the dew is on your branch, and he will not cast you out. Come in the heat of the noon, when the drought of care parches you, and he will not cast you out. Come when the shadows have grown long, and the darkness of night is gathering about you. He will not cast you out. The door is not shut, for the gate of mercy is closed is not so long as the gate of life is open. In other words, dear friends, as long as you're living, there's hope to come to Jesus. So here's the last question. Will you come? Will you come? God has already contrived everything necessary for your salvation, and there is nothing wanting except your consent. If I have to take my children to the hospital for something and they have to do some emergency surgery, many times the doctors will say, most of the time, if not all the time, they will say, I need the consent of the parent. We cannot go forward until we get your consent, because they're helpless. They can't do anything. And then if I give my consent, they can take the matter into their hands. When it comes to this matter of salvation, the Bible teaches that God has taken the entire matter of salvation and redemption in his own hands. He's not left any part for you to finish. There's nothing else for you to do. Satisfaction has been made. Righteousness has been displayed. Death and hell has been conquered. All the difficulties that we faced that were in the way, he has removed by his life and by his death and by his resurrection. Jesus, the Son of God, has triumphed over all of them. And now he sits at the right hand and he offers salvation to all who believes. Jesus stands at the door, according to Revelation chapter 3, and he knocks. He knocks, and the Bible says, whoever opens the door, whoever gives the consent, he will come into them and dine with them, and he with them. The Word of God says that all that remains is your consent. Will you give it? Will you give your consent? If you die and go to hell, it will be at your own choice. The difficulty lies within your own heart. God has done everything necessary to purchase your soul, to make salvation available. Now the consent is with you. And if you die and go to hell, it'll be because you chose death over life. Will you come to Jesus today? Do you hear the Savior speaking? Come, follow me. Open the door. He'll come in. The gospel solves the problem of discrimination by declaring there's only one way of salvation, and it's through faith in Jesus. Last, how does the gospel solve the problem of law keeping? Law keeping. Answer, the gospel establishes the law. Verse 31. Do we then nullify the law through faith? May it never be. On the contrary, we establish the law. Now you see that word in verse 31, nullify? Underline it in your Bible. It means to cancel it. It means to neutralize the effect of it. You see, a firearm is a deadly weapon. But in order to neutralize it, in order to nullify it, you need to remove its bullets and then turn the handle or the shaft of it downward. Then you nullify its effect. You reduce it to nothing. You nullify it. The word establish here is a very interesting word that's used in verse 31. At the end of verse 31, it means to make to stand. We make the law to stand. The gospel makes it to stand. Some versions use the word uphold. And Paul is addressing the Jewish critic who would say, wait a minute, Paul, are you setting the gospel against the law? Are you saying that the gospel makes the law amount to nothing? In other words, what's all this talk about justification by grace due to the law? The apostle responds with a very emphatic statement. It's an emphatic statement of denial. May it never be. On the contrary, we establish the law. In other words, what Paul says is this. By shifting our focus from what we do to what God does, we don't cancel out God's law. What happens is, in fact, we put the entire way of life into its proper place. We actually are confirming the law. Now, John Owen, that great redwood among the Puritans, says that Paul's answer in verse 31 is really a passing thought. What Paul is doing is he's looking ahead. He's anticipating addressing this issue in chapter 6. But he just makes this little statement because he knows he's going to address it in chapter 6. And when we get to chapter 6, we'll find that that's the case. He addresses this issue in detail. But what does Paul mean when he says that we establish the law? Well, let's be clear about what the law does and what the law does not do. According to chapter 3, verse 20, we already discovered that through the law comes what? The knowledge of sin. Not the knowledge of salvation, but the knowledge of sin. One of the greatest effects of sin on the human race is that it has a blinding effect. Sin actually makes us unconscious of our real need. Now, God knows perfectly what we are. But we don't. And the law is given to help us to see what God already knows. It's kind of like a thermometer. A person who may be really sick with a fever. And you may go to them and you say, well, friend, you don't look too well. And they may say, well, you don't look so sharp yourself. You know? But what happens is that if you can get that friend a thermometer, and in about 60 seconds, he'll know what the case is. God has given us the law, and the law is like a thermometer. It shows us what God already knows to be true. And that is, we suffer from the fever of sin. We suffer from a fever of corruption. We're born with a temperature, if you will, and we don't know how dangerous it is. And God's law comes and sticks the thermometer in our mouth so that we recognize we have a high-grade fever and we need to get some help. The law not only was given to show us our sin, but the law was given to show us that our need is immediate. We don't need help later on, but we need help right away because the wrath of God is revealed against those who transgress his laws. The law not only shows us our sin and shows us our need, but the law pronounces a judgment on us. It pronounces condemnation. It threatens, but it cannot help you. It wounds, but it cannot heal you. The law has no strength to dethrone sin in your life. It can even destroy sin in your life. It exposes, it condemns, and it gives no power for you to oppose it. The law brings the will of God to man, but it gives no power for us to obey it. It's like a road map. A road map that directs us on a journey, but it gives us no car to drive. This is really described by John Bunyan in Pilgrim's Progress by Faithful. He puts it this way. He says, Faithful went on. Now, when I had gotten over halfway up the hill, I looked, and behind me I saw someone coming after me as swiftly as the wind. He overtook me just about the place where the bench stands. That's the place where I sat down to rest myself, remarked Christian. But being overcome by sleep, I lost the document out of my coat. But dear brother, hear me out, said Faithful. As soon as the man overtook me, he was but a word and a blow, and he knocked me down and laid me out for dead. But after I had somewhat come to my senses, I asked him, why did you do that to me? He said, it was because of my secret inclination to follow after Adam the first. And with that, he struck me with another deadly blow on the chest and beat me down backwards so that I laid at his foot as if I were dead. And when I came to myself again, I cried for him to have mercy. And this is what he said. I don't know how to show mercy. And with that, he knocked me down again. And no doubt he would have made an end of me, except that another individual came by and caused him to stop. Who was that that made him stop? Said Christian, or asked Christian. I didn't know him at first, answered Faithful. But as he went by, I saw the holes in his hands and in his side. And then I concluded that it was the Lord. That man who overtook you was Moses, explained Christian. He spares no one, and he doesn't know how to show mercy to those who transgress his law. Jesus said these very words in John chapter 6. The Jews were placing their confidence in Moses. And he said, Moses testified about me. Moses can't have mercy upon you, but I am the Lord of mercy. Listen, the law pronounces judgment, but it does not save. But it's also a tutor. The law is a tutor to lead us to Jesus. Can I just show you one more verse as we come to the conclusion? Galatians chapter 3, verse 24. You're familiar with this verse, but I want to just conclude with this truth here and then try to make some practical application. Galatians 3, verse 24. Quickly now, as we come to the conclusion. Galatians 3, verse 24. The Apostle Paul says in Galatians chapter 3, verse 24, therefore, the law has become our tutor to lead us to Christ so that we may be justified by faith. Do you see it? Come on, take the time and look at it. It's right there, and it's very important in the Greek world. There was a household servant. That servant was not a schoolmaster, and they weren't a teacher, they weren't a principal. They were usually an old and trusted slave who had been in the family for a long time, but who was well respected. This tutor was in charge of the child's moral welfare. It was their duty to make sure that all of the qualities that are essential to adulthood came in their lives. And so every day this tutor had one particular duty. Every day they had to make sure that the children would get to and from school safely. They had nothing to do with teaching. It was their duty to get them to school, deliver them to the teacher, and then after school was over, to get them home. That's the function of the law, according to the Apostle Paul. According to the Apostle, the law doesn't bring us into Christ's presence. That's the Spirit's role. The law takes us up to the school and then points to the teacher. It says, that's the one you must learn from. And then the Spirit leads us in by faith. The law cannot bring salvation, but to those who gain salvation by trusting Christ, then we are turned around and directed back to the law, not that we might be saved, but that we might know what it means to love. The law defines what it means to love God and to love others. And so the law leads us to the schoolhouse, points us to Christ. The Spirit leads us into His presence to be saved by faith. And then Christ says, you want to know what it means to love me? Look at the law. Do you want to know what it means to love others? Look at the law. But you'll get no power from it. You get the power from me. And not only does He give the power to live, but He gives peace when we fail. Because if you try to keep the law, you will see that you fail again and again and again. And your salvation is not assured by law keeping, but it's by the blood of Jesus. So if someone asks you, Pastor, how do you know you're saved? How do you know if you know God? There's only one answer. Faith in Jesus alone. Well, don't you have to read your Bible every day? Don't you have to pray every day? Don't you have to witness? Don't you have to give? No, I don't have to do those things. I want to, but I don't have to. In order for me to be saved, I must trust Christ. And once I do, I want to keep the law. I love the law. I just have no power to do it except in Jesus. Amen. We confirm the place of the law. And so in closing, what do we learn? We learn that the gospel establishes the law by first of all giving the law its proper place. That's right. It gives it its proper place. How do we establish the law? We establish the law by not only the law being given its proper place, but as we trust Christ, we apply the truth, then we discover that we refuse to lower the standards of the law. And then we make the law meaningful because we view it in light of the cross. And we practice it because it's only possible in the power of the Spirit. Now, I asked someone last week, how do I help you all understand the book of Romans better? And they said, Pastor, he said to me, Pastor, we just need more practical application. So I'm going to try to give that to you. Number one, don't make the law a standard for being saved. Christ is the end of the law. So whenever you find yourself judging your own salvation or judging someone else's salvation by what they do, stop yourself. It is not based upon what they do. It's based upon what Christ has done. And are they trusting in that? Number two, when you break the law, don't despise it. The law is good. Just run to Jesus. And then finally, when others fall short, forgive them. Because you fall short of the law too. Okay? There'll be many in your life who fall short of the law of God. They don't do what's right, but neither do you. So forgive them. And forgive them because Jesus has forgiven you. Okay? Let's pray. Father, thank you for solving through your truth some of our greatest problems. Help us not to boast in what we can do, but in what you've done. Help us to not be prejudiced against anybody in any condition, but help us to take this good news to whosoever wills. Lord, we want to keep your law. We love your law. But Jesus, we trust you for the power to do so. And when we fall short, we will trust in your finished work on our behalf. We pray these things in your precious name.